managed his emergency ascent. He couldn't do anything more, and he knew he couldn't do anything more. He called for help. There's a whole big boat there, a boat that's been involved in an industry for years. He is retrievable. He is attached to the ship. How can they not get him? How can they not know what to do?
A haunting question from a haunted mother. Why indeed did her pearl-diving son die that day off the northwestern Australian coast? And is Australia's pearl industry as safe as it should be? Welcome to Four Corners. Australia's pearling industry is worth some $200 million a year because pearls from here are amongst the world's most beautiful and most expensive. Business has been incredibly good for one family company in particular, the Paspaley Company. But for the pearl divers, it's a dangerous exercise, in which an industry code of practice is self-regulated, in contrast to tougher, enforceable regulations for divers working in the oil and gas industries. The common technique in pearling is called drift diving, and as you're about to see, it's demanding and extremely challenging. There have been no drift diving deaths in the industry for more than 20 years, and the Paspaley Company says it hasn't had a work-related death at least since records began in the 60s. But tonight's program suggests that that safety record may now be tarnished. It tells the story of a young, fit and experienced diver who died in mysterious circumstances. You'll also hear from a former senior company diver who left after warning that a serious accident was just waiting to happen. Here is the result of Debbie Whitmont's investigation.
It was Saturday night, the 14th of April, a South Melbourne suburb, and the middle of the night door knock that every family dreads hearing. It was the police.
The police were at the door. Of course, you have a lot of things running through your mind, and I was just hoping that one of my boys was at the police station in a lot of trouble, basically. That's what I was hoping.
It was nearly 4 a.m. and two of the Hamptons' three boys were already home in bed. But their oldest son, Jared, who was 22, was on the other side of the country on a pearl boat off the remote coast of northwestern Australia.
The police insisted we sit down before they say anything. And that's when we knew it was something very, very serious that we didn't want to admit to ourselves.
Kept asking.
But we had to sit down.
Kept asking them at the door, please don't tell us it's bad news.
So we were just absolutely, totally distraught, quite obviously. And when the police sat us down, they asked us if we're the parents of Jared. And just basically, I think
I can't remember whether they said he drowned, and I said, did the whole boat sink? I mean, how can that happen? I mean, has the whole boat sunk? And they said, just Jared.
The Hamptons were given a phone number for the police in Broome.
I rang them twice because I said, there must be something wrong. You must have the wrong name. And they said no, and I insisted. I said, you must have the wrong name. And so then they just assured us that they're sorry, but it was Jared. And so we went up there.
It had only been Jared Hampton's second day on the job, working as a pearl diver for the biggest pearl producer in Australia, Paspaley Pearls. James Paspaley met Jared Hampton's family in Broome.
They took us to our room and they pulled together the chairs around the table and they said, now ask us some questions. And I looked at James and I said, well, what happened?
The Hamptons were told that during the second last dive of the day, Jared had come to the surface early and waved his hand for help.
He made an emergency ascent. We don't know what happened underwater for him to make that emergency ascent, but he did. He was in trouble of some sort, and they got him back to the boat basically and couldn't revive him.
Ever since Jared died, his family has been trying to understand what went wrong.
He arrived on the surface alive. He raised his arm. There's even talk that he called out twice for help. Now, this is where the whole issue begins. Jared was alive.
For Jared Hampton, life had only just been beginning.
Yeah, he had a lot of friends, yeah. He's a very confident, natural person, and I think that's what most people saw in him. He was so good. He was always coming for a hug. You know, he wouldn't just shake your hand. He was just such a happy person to be around, very positive. He got along with everyone.
Oh, he's always a very lively character, very happy-go-lucky character, very popular boy, full of life, always was. He's a difficult child to catch up with a lot of the time.
Jared did love water. He loved surf. And I remember when he was 15 and big and the surf was big and I knew it was too big for me, I pulled him in and I said, Jazz, I said, you've gone too far. I said, now you're out the back. I can't get you.
We're in Tulum, out the back in the jungle, and we're about to go dive the El Pit cenote.
Last year, Jared and his best friend Lockie Ford went diving at the Pit, an inland cave near the east coast of Mexico.
You jump into a hole and then all of a sudden it's just this incredible new world. Stalactites, stalagmites that have grown when the cave was out of water 150 million years ago. It's a different energy. The whole time we were just blown away, sort of looking at each other just like, this is incredible. Straight up and down, like Jared was, he loved diving. And he came out of the water with sort of tears of joy in your mask.
Jared's love of diving ran in the family. His mother, Robin, used to be a dive master herself.
Oh, it just surprised me that he should end up doing what once his mum had done. But no, I was surprised that he was so taken by it.
Love you, Mummy.
Jared Hampton was a qualified diving instructor and worked in the Whitsundays with tourists. But he wanted to get a skipper's licence, and that meant building up his hours at sea. His friend Lockie Ford met someone who worked at Pasbele Pearls.
They were very excited about the whole idea of Pasbele Pearls. They had a look at the website, and the website spruced world standard safety conditions, and it was a very big company with great equipment. And of course, there was the excitement of exploring the Kimberley and Broome and those areas as well. You know, there was a certain element of excitement about it as well.
All that Pasbele asked for pearl diving, was a basic scuba certificate. So Jared sent off his resume, and in mid-January, he got a phone call.
And it was his eventual skipper, Ron, who rang up and just said, you're on my boat. I want you here by middle of February.
Hi, it's Tony Hampton. Yeah, I'm Jared's father.
Tony Hampton rang Pasbele Pearls and spoke to the fleet manager.
Just ringing because...
He was as reassuring as possible. My last question to him that day was, OK, stupid question, I know, but is it dangerous? To which he said, absolutely. Diving is dangerous, full stop. And I said, yeah, sure, OK, I understand that.
Yes, and of course, very concerned about safety procedures.
And what did he say about safety?
They gave us an assurance that, you know, they had backup and they had facilities for
rescuing divers in dangerous positions.
In February, Jared Hampton left home for Darwin. He was going to work for a company run by one of the richest families in Australia.
Even we heard down here that Passepalais have a very good safety record and that they have a lot of great safety features, and we thought, thank goodness he's going with such a good company. Isn't he lucky to have had got a job with them?
The Passepalais family has built its fortune on pearling. From one pearl lugger in the 1930s, Passepalais Pearls now brings in more than $100 million a year. And it's still a family business, ruled by Nick Passepalais, a Companion of the Order of Australia, and run by his oldest son, James. But Passepalais isn't only about pearling. There's Pearl Aviation, Aero Rescue and Pearl Marine. There are the family's cattle stations, the family's real estate, the family jet, and an interest in the Darwin Detention Centre. And the Passepalais' wealth is growing. This year, the Passepalais family moved up the rich list to become the 13th richest family in Australia, worth an estimated $900 million.
Yeah, it was all positive, you know, it was all positive. When we were up in Darwin, we were, you know, both just stoked to be part of this company.
In Darwin, before starting as pearl divers, Jared Hampton and Lockie Ford first had to do a compulsory 3-day course and pass an exam run by the Pearl Producers Association, or PPA, an industry lobby group of which Passepalais Pearls is the most powerful member, and James Passepalais is the chairman.
We did overviews of safety on the boat. We did overviews of marine hazards, which predominantly revolved around sort of protecting yourself from irukandji, because they probably are the biggest threat.
Jellyfish.
Yeah, the little irukandji jellyfish.
The only practical part of the course involved a half day in a Darwin swimming pool. Jono Davis did the course last year.
How well do you feel that it prepared you for actually going in and doing the diving, given that you're pretty experienced?
At the time, when I was doing the course, I thought it was pretty reasonable, but in hindsight, there's so much more that the course could have involved. However, it's...
Like what?
Like diving in an actual, like, ocean.
Before working with tourists, Jared Hampton had done an advanced course in sea safety. And to become a scuba instructor, he'd had to learn to do rescues in the water. But there's nothing like that required for pearl diving.
What procedures do you teach in the course?
We asked the pearl producers what the new divers are taught for rescuing divers in trouble in the water.
The course runs through the use of bailout bottles, which is a independent source of air that every diver carries.
That's for rescuing yourself. What about for rescuing another diver?
They're also given instruction on removing unconscious divers from the water. But the
are they?
Yes.
But if those in this year's course were taught to rescue other divers, they don't remember it.
What procedures did they teach you for rescuing somebody in the water?
That is something that we haven't covered. Yeah, we in sort of saying that the boats, it's about your self-helping yourself out of a dangerous situation.
So are you saying there was no procedure for rescuing somebody in the water?
Well, as far as I can recall, we haven't touched on anything like that.
What procedure were you taught if another diver needed rescuing?
I can't remember one that stands out, actually.
Do you think there was one at all?
Not that I can remember.
And surprisingly, the industry says the three-day course isn't meant to train new divers for drift diving.
The induction course is not a training course, and that needs to be clearly stated. It's an induction.
So if people leave the course and they're not ready to do drift diving, what are they ready to do?
They're ready to do whatever the company wants them to do.
This year, that meant Paspaley sent Jared Hampton and others straight to Broome to go drift diving. These days in Broome, the Pearl capital, the dangers of pearl diving are sold as part of its history. But over the decades, though the hard hats have gone, the job of collecting shells from the bottom of the ocean has changed very little. Even now, Broome's pearlers are ruled by the tides. They only go out near the quarter moon or the neap when the tides are smallest. And still today, those on land wait for their return. By the neap tide in April, Jared Hampton was on the Paspaley 2 and getting ready to head south to 80 Mile Beach, where Paspaley collects large wild oyster shells to make cultured pearls at its pearl farms.
He was excited. He was looking forward to the adventure of it all. He was looking forward to the challenge of it all. He thought he had a great future.
Mm. Were you worried?
Yes. I was always worried about it, yeah.
Yeah, we felt sick.
There wasn't a time I could go into water where I didn't think about Jared and what he was doing.
The Paspaley 2 had 8 divers, as well as an engineer, cook, domestic, deckhand, and a skipper, Ron Watson. As it left Broome on the 12th of April, 5 of the 8 divers on board were about to do what's known as drift diving for the very first time. And it was also Sam Morton's first trip as head diver.
Drift diving is very demanding on your body. I don't think they could really teach that anywhere. Or I don't think anyone would believe you if you told them what to expect.
What you can hear underwater, the whole time was just whoop, 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 and there's just a propeller going around and around, and bubbles, like Darth Vader, all you can see is and then just bubbles.
The Paspaley 2 works with 4 drift divers of either side. The divers breathe through long yellow air hoses, which are also the only things keeping them attached to the boat.
Well, basically, they call it drift diving because we get pulled behind a boat.
The boat moves constantly, and underwater, each diver has a weighted work line which he has to hold on to while picking up the shells.
We have to physically hold on to a rope and get dragged by the boat underwater. So you can imagine the pain in your hands and your arms and not being able to just let go.
Each day in 9 45-minute dives, each diver is dragged along at a depth of about 15 metres underwater for around 20 kilometres. Often, each diver can't even see the diver next to him.
You have to physically hold on for 9 dives a day. Sometimes if the boat's going a bit quick or if you turn round, you'll hit the end of the rope, like you'll hit the warning knot. By the time you spin around to grab it, sometimes it'll shoot off.
If a diver lets go of his rope or work line, the only way to get back to the boat is by pulling himself up his yellow air hose to the surface.
Well, then you see the boat, and the boat's long, 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 long way away. And you have to pull all the way up your hose.
Getting back is exhausting.
You can't stop the boat. The boat's not just going to stop and wait for you to get there. It's just all upper strength from there and pull yourself all the way to the front.
But one of the hardest parts of the job comes at the end of every dive, when each diver has to swim his big bag of shells across the work lines to an underwater winch near the boat which is still moving forward.
So the boat's still going forward and you're trying to find a winch to clip on. And it's all right for the guy in the number one line because it's right in front of him, it drops down right in front of him. But the outside two divers, they have to swim quite a long distance and not much visibility and guess on like a bearing to know which way to go to clip a bag onto this ring.
Between each dive, there's 20 minutes on deck for shell cleaning and a snack. Then it's back in the water 9 times a day, from first light to darkness. So much time in the water makes the divers' wetsuits chafe their skin off.
Because when you sign up, you're not told that you're going to have holes like drilled into your elbows and your knees, so you're missing skin and you got blood coming out your nose every day, and you, middle of the night, your hands are throbbing so hard you can't sleep. Your fingernails are all lifted off your fingers, and clenching onto rope as tight as you can all day. You know, you're not used to that.
It's hard to know how much of that anyone told Jared Hampton. On the first day out, he was on line 2, next to the head diver, Sam Morton, on line 1.
He seemed real good under the water, comfy, he had all his right gear, he was good.
Did he seem to be enjoying it?
Yeah, he was loving it.
But as head diver, Sam Morton had a problem. Though it was his job to supervise new divers, there were 5 on the boat, and he could only properly watch one of them at a time.
It's always going to be a worry with that amount of new workers in any workforce, let alone a dangerous job like diving in underwater. So, yeah, it was always playing on my mind about what the new guys are doing under the water and how they're getting on.
So on the second day out, the new divers were rotated and Jared Hampton was moved to line 3, which meant he was now in between 2 first-time drift divers. During the second dive of the day, Jared struck trouble. The visibility had suddenly dropped to 0.
Yeah, we hit what we call a mud monster, which is when the vis drops right out to nothing. And so the dive got called off.
Jared Hampton later told Sam Morton he'd let go of his work line to swim his big bag of shells to the winch, but he missed it.
It'd be like trying to walk through a cloud in the sky, not being able to see where you go and just guessing where you're going. And he just judged it wrong. Easy to do for a new diver. Just ended up missing all the ropes together. Ended up going right out the back of the boat.
Sam Morton saw him and swam out and helped. Later on deck, they talked about it.
And he said, oh, it's hard working. I said, yeah, mate, it's hard work. When something like that happens, you won't be doing that again, will you? He goes, no, definitely won't be doing that again. So at that stage, I thought, tick that off the list. Jared knows all about that, you know. If he's out the back, he knows what to do.
How did he seem?
Good. He had a bit of a laugh. Yeah, I won't be doing that again. He just knew. I could see it in his eyes that he knew not to do that again.
Does that mean he knew not to let go of the work rope, do you think?
Yep.
But later that day, Jared Hampton lost his work line again. On either the 6th or 7th dive, he told another diver on the boat that he almost drowned.
He got into trouble, he lost his work line, and he told me he nearly drowned. And I just sort of laughed at him, thought it was a figure of speech, but he didn't laugh back, which was unusual for him because he's always laughing and joking. And that's when I realised that he was serious.
So if that happened to you a couple of times in a day, particularly if you were new, how do you think you'd be feeling?
You can't breathe. Honestly, just absolutely shattered. Absolutely shattered.
I said, oh, are you okay? And he's, yeah, I'm all right. Just need to have a smoke. And he's trying to roll a cigarette. And then he didn't have time because we run out, the 20 minutes was over and we had to chip our shells and all that. And then so he had to throw his smoke and got back in.
It was the eighth dive of the day. It would be Jarrett Hampton's last. 2 days after Jarrett died, his family spoke to the crew and the skipper.
The skipper told us that the deckhand came to him in the cabin and said, "There is a diver up," and I think he yelled help.
At that point, Jarrett was about 30 to 50 metres away from the boat. It's unclear at what point the skipper realised there was an emergency. The skipper said he slowed the boat down slightly.
I said, "How long before you took that action?" He said, "About a minute." So there was no action for about a minute. Then all he did was slow the boat 0.2 of a knot and then went about knocking the divers up.
But the skipper hadn't given the divers an emergency signal. So he said he had to call them up a second time.
When Jarrett didn't report at his decompression station, he again said, "I'll give him another minute," assuming he's having trouble with his shell bag. This is in light, despite the fact that Jarrett had surfaced and acknowledged, had yelled out help.
This idea that Jarrett's having trouble with his shell bag, I'll just give him another minute. What, another minute to drown? I mean, you've only knocked them up because Jarrett came up distressed and Jarrett still hasn't risen. Why give him another minute?
But there was no one on deck equipped to jump in for a rescue. And according to best practice, there should have been. Dr. Carl Edmonds has more than 40 years' experience in diving safety. He says the Australian standard, which is followed by most occupational divers, says that where divers are working underwater, there should at least be a standby diver on deck.
The standby diver is the one that goes to the person quickly, very rapidly. He's already dressed, raring to go the whole time, rescues the diver, brings him to the surface, and then you've got to have a way of getting him onto the safety boat and on the safety boat have some form of resuscitation. That's what you need. You've only got a minute or two. You can't be frigging around saying, "Oh, what do we do now?"
But the Paspaley 2 didn't have a safety boat or a standby diver, and no emergency signal was given.
There is no procedure if there's an emergency because they haven't got the things they need. They don't have the equipment, they don't have the boat, they don't have the standby diver. They don't even have a real effective way of calling the people to the surface. You know, any reasonable diving operation, you can call, there's an obvious emergency signal.
But though the Australian standard recommends a standby diver, it's a standard, not a law. So the pearl producers say they don't have to follow it.
If you don't have a standby diver, how do you get a diver who is in trouble in the water?
Well, the boats themselves have to work that capacity out and work out how they do that. And in most cases, the diver is retrieved by either dragging on the hose or they will go and pick him up if he's available there.
Why not have a standby diver?
The pearling industry doesn't feel it necessary to have a standby diver.
In the water, though Sam Morton had heard the knock-up signal, he had no way of knowing there was anything wrong.
I thought, maybe Jarrett must have gone up to the top. And I just thought, because Jarrett had done it on dive two, maybe he's done it on dive eight and he's just a bit tired. He's gone up to the boat and Ron's called it off.
It wasn't till about 5 minutes later, while doing his end of dive decompression, that Sam Morton happened to look upwards.
I looked up and that's when I looked back and I saw the skipper and the engineer in the water swimming, and I looked back and that's when I saw Jarrett. He was just face down and they were trying to help him out, and that's when it all sort of just, like a bit of a sledgehammer, like, oh shit, something's happened here, you know.
The deckhand was pulling Jarrett to the boat by his air hose.
Jarrett was just face down in the water, basically being dragged by his hose, just the deckie had started pulling him in.
But drift divers don't wear buoyancy compensators. And Jared's face was in the water, with his mask full of bubbles.
Went up as quick as I could, swam out to him. First thing I did was, oh, he's got a breeze, so I spun him around so his head was out of the water.
Sam and Jared were about 20 or 30 metres from the boat.
So I just hooked my arm in his bailout, swam back to the boat as quick as I could, and with the boat moving, that's pretty slow, but I did it as quick as I could.
But the drift divers had never practised a procedure for rescuing a diver in trouble in the water.
I sat up on the ladder, I pulled him out of the water, tried to get his mouth up out of the water, tried to see if he was breathing, give him a bit of a shake. Come on, Jared, wake up. Started talking to him. Come on, buddy, have a breath, have a breath.
But even though they'd reached the ladder, there was nothing to help get an unconscious diver out of the water.
And I said to them, how did you get Jazz up? And they said, up here. And I said, up that ladder? And they said, yes, and it was very difficult and awkward. And I said, that's the way you got my son up out of the water? And they said, yes.
As Jared Hampton was being pulled out on one side, Jade Theodore was getting out of the water on the other. He says it was about 15 minutes after he'd heard the second signal to the divers.
It was about 15 minutes by the time I got on deck, and Jared was being pulled out of the water on the opposite side to me at the same time I stepped on deck. He'd been pulled out.
How long do you believe Jared was in the water for?
Close to 20 minutes.
After he signalled?
After he signalled.
Now, we are the first to say maybe they could never have revived him. We would accept that. But we cannot accept that he was in the water for up to 10 to 20 minutes with no chance of revival.
On deck, Sam and the skipper did CPR for nearly an hour.
We kept going. Yeah, I didn't want to stop. Just thought for some miracle he might come around, take a breath.
Not one of the four boats in the fleet carried a defibrillator, but one did carry body bags. It took the Paspaley 2 8 hours to get Jared's body back to Broome.
Jared has yelled out twice and waved his arm. He made the surface. He alerted the people on the boat that he was in trouble.
He pulled off his end of the deal. Whatever occurred underneath, he managed it. He managed his emergency ascent. He couldn't do anything more, and he knew he couldn't do anything more. He called for help. There's a whole big boat there, a boat that's been involved in an industry for years. He's retrievable. He's attached to the ship. How can they not get him? How can they not know what to do?
Divers deserve better than this. These are people who are going into very dangerous areas. They're doing very hazardous diving. It's very, very hard work. They need the basic stuff, which is given to you in the manuals. If you're not going to do the basic stuff, then there's something wrong with the system.
We may never know exactly why Jared Hampton came to the surface that day and signalled for help. But it wasn't only the lack of emergency equipment and procedures that failed him. According to some of the company's most experienced divers, whatever happened underwater might well have been avoided. It was only a matter of money. When Mick Case heard Jared Hampton had died, he says he was disgusted, but he wasn't surprised.
No one was surprised. A lot of people in the community down here, they're not in pearling, weren't surprised because they know what the industry is, what it demands of you.
Mick Case used to be Paspaley's head company diver.
Yep, that's the Roebuck 2 on the left.
He says it wasn't safe for the Paspaley 2 to have had so many first-time divers.
I think it's over 30 years old now or something.
How many green divers would you say is safe on a boat?
One to two max.
But the Paspaley too had five first-time drift divers, which made it impossible for the head diver to closely monitor all of them.
Does that mean the head diver can meet the terms of his contract?
No. Because you're supposed to closely monitor it, and the only way you can closely monitor someone is if they're right beside you on the number two line. You can't have five divers on one line. They should be heading to sea tomorrow. That's the beginning of the night.
But Mick Case isn't the only one to have recently left Paspaley. Last year, another nine senior divers quit the company, taking with them more than 80 years of drift diving experience. And many were replaced by first-time drift divers.
With a mass exodus like that, you can't put that many green divers in the water with a few experienced guys to look after them.
So what did you think when you heard they'd all gone?
I thought there's going to be a fatality soon.
With all the danger and discomfort, very few would do drift diving if it wasn't for the money. A few years ago, Mick Case and Sam Morton were picking up 500 shells a day, being paid $4.50 for each of them and making around $80,000 a season. But as the GFC started, Paspaley began dropping its shell price, often only telling the divers that their pay would be cut at the beginning of the season as they were about to sign their contracts.
They just tell us, this is how it is. Here's your contract, sign it. If you don't like it, leave.
By 2011, Paspaley had put the shell price down by a dollar to $3.50 a shell, which for a good diver meant a pay cut of $20,000 a season. In April last year, with the economy picking back up, Sam Morton and others wrote to Paspaley asking for the shell price to start going up again. If it didn't, they warned, the company would struggle to keep its experienced divers.
And what response did you get to that letter?
Not a positive one.
What do you mean by that?
Sort of got shrugged off, basically.
When Paspaley refused to offer any more money, its experienced divers began leaving, and many were replaced by first-time drift divers.
Were you worried about the number of new divers, the greenies?
Yes.
Was there anything you could do about that?
Nothing I hadn't already tried to tell the company.
When Jared Norton heard of Jared Hampton's death, he was furious.
Angry. Anger. It was just anger. So all these people that left, you know, decades and decades of experience, we all started to leave and we all knew it was going to happen.
And what really disturbs Jared Norton is that at the end of last year, he told Paspaley management that if nothing changed, it was likely that this season somebody would die. He gave the warning when a senior Paspaley manager offered him a job as a head diver. He didn't want it.
I just didn't want that responsibility of that many lives. And I said to the person in question, I said, I promise you, I guarantee you next year you'll have a serious accident or a fatality unless something changes. And he said, we'll cross that hurdle when we get to it. And that was enough for me. And I was like, I didn't want any part of that.
How do you think they could have avoided this death?
Kept the money where it was, really.
Now back home in New Zealand, Sam Morton is devastated by Jared Hampton's death.
Oh, yeah, it's been pretty hard. Pretty gutting having to leave Purling like that.
Sam Morton says it would have cost Paspaley about $500,000 to put the shell price back up and hold on to its experienced divers. It's about the price of a top-of-the-range necklace.
Well, going on the numbers, the quotas for the company, We had 500,000 shell to catch. 500,000 to take it back up to the original 450, which is where it should be. That's not a lot of money to pay out us divers. All the good workers there who wanted to be there, who wanted to do their thing for the company, wanted to help out, took pride in what we were doing, went the extra mile for the boat. It's not a lot of money to keep a real good workforce.
Do you think that $500,000 might have helped save a life?
Yes, definitely. I think the percentage would have gone up of him, of someone being able to help him, if he was between experienced divers. I can't say it would have saved him or not, but all I can say, and I know, that the percentage would have been a lot higher of someone seeing something happen to him, someone being close enough there to help him out, if we had more experienced divers on the boat than just having two experienced divers.
There are only two things we know for sure. This is the last thing in the world he would have wished on his family and friends.
In Melbourne, there were 900 people at Jared Hampton's funeral.
He'd become a man and his potential was enormous, but we don't get to see his future, which will be a constant source of sadness and loss for all of us.
And so, Jessie, I love you and I honour you and I honour the infinite potential and wisdom that is within you. Thank you.
James Paspaley and his father, Nick, were there too and expressed their regrets. Both declined an interview with Four Corners on the grounds that investigations are ongoing, but said in a statement that safety is Paspaley's highest priority. Within days of Jared Hampton's death, the Paspaley fleet went back out pearling. Four Corners has been told the boats now keep a mask and flippers on the back deck in case of an emergency. The pearling industry says there's no need for it to make changes because Jared Hampton's death still hasn't been fully investigated.
The authorities have no concerns in regards to how we're operating at the moment, and they've allowed the vessels to continue to go. The industry will continue to operate in what it believes to be the manner in which it's operated for some time. And if we have to make adjustments and make changes at the end of the investigations, then we will do so.
2 days after Jared Hampton died, his family was taken out to visit the Paspaley too.
The whole trip out was just terribly sad, just very solemn. We got out to the boat, got on board, had a bit of a look around, went down into the cabin, saw Jared's bed and his belongings and guitar sitting there. Had a look at the gear around the back of the boat, the blackboard where they chalk up their catch. And then we went to get Jared's equipment and clothes and belongings. And as we're motoring back towards Broome, it was an absolutely brilliant sky out. And it was a very, very emotional trip.
The Hamptons point out it wouldn't cost Paspaley much to make the boats safer. What they can't understand is why, even after Jared's death, it still hasn't been done.
I mean, what does it take before these boats are stopped? Jared died. We don't want him to have died in vain. Simple as that.
Police investigations are continuing into Jared Hampton's death. There is a Western Australian WorkSafe inquiry, but it could take up to 3 years, and a preliminary report has found that Jared Hampton's death was consistent with drowning. To date, a coronial inquest has not been announced. The Paspaley Company declined to be interviewed for the program, but in written answers to questions, it says it would be misleading to allege that any change in pearl shell price has caused any increase in safety risk for divers. The company's full response is on our website, abc.net.au/fourcorners. That's the program for tonight. Join us again next Monday, but for now, good night.